come, let us sing for joy to the Lord.
Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before him with thanksgiving
and extol him with music and song.
For the Lord is the great God,
the great King above all gods.
In his hand are the depths of the earth,
and the mountain peaks belong to him.
The sea is his,
for he made it,
and his hands formed the dry land.
Come, let us bow down in worship,
and let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture,
the flock under his care.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving,
and his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him.
Bless his name.
For the Lord is good.
His steadfast love endures forever.
And his faithfulness.
His faithfulness.
His faithfulness.
And his faithfulness to all generations.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the AMKMC Methodist Church online worship service. As we begin service this morning, you may wish to get a copy of the e-bulletin. In the bulletin is the service order for this morning's service, and also news and information about AMKMC Methodist Church. By now, you probably would have started to get used to the routine of worshipping online on Sunday. And as that happens, we may find ourselves beginning to slacken as the sense of routine and mundane sets in. I want to encourage all of you to continue to commit yourselves to seeking God and worshipping Him during this period that we have online services. There are a few things you can do to help yourself. Firstly, be prepared. Before the start of the service, make sure that you have everything set up so that you are not scrambling last minute. Do also make preparations to remove any distractions during service time. Secondly, participate in the service. Sing, pray, respond at the appropriate time of the service. Remember, we are gathered here to worship and not watch a show. Lastly, expect to meet with God. Remind yourself that God is still working despite the extraordinary circumstances, and have the right frame of mind throughout the service. Our prayer is that you will be blessed even as we hold steadfast to the discipline of coming together and worshipping God. Let's prepare to respond to the call to worship. Remember that it is God who is the one who is calling us together. We hear the voice of God calling.
Love your neighbor as yourself.
We feel the Spirit moving among us,
moving us to acts of love and building others up.
We know the love of Jesus.
We love because Christ first loved us.
Come, worship God together. All together, come,
let us worship our God who calls us by name.
Done great. be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God, you do great.
Good morning. Now let us continue in worship and end that time of prayer. And so may I invite you just to quieten your hearts in your own way, and after which you'll join us in this corporate prayer. They quietly close your own prayer now. And let me begin by reading to you the scripture taken from Psalm 34, verse 18. It says, "The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and save the crushed in the spirit." Let's pray. We thank you, God, for your word to us this morning to assure us that you are always near to the brokenhearted and to those who are crushed in the spirit. Many of us, Lord, are in such situation today as we face COVID-19 daily. We pray you will draw us close to you, that we will be given the strength and peace in this troubling time, in this moment of our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we thank you that we learn from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 to 16, which says, "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but at wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil." So Lord, we pray as we confine in our own way. We thank you for the scripture reminding us to be wise in making use of the time that given to us, that help us be fruitful whatever we do, especially for you and for others. I also thank you that Singapore is preparing to open up in the month of June. That we ask that we again to move it in a very cautious way, so that all the good work, hard work that we put in these months will not go to waste. So watch over us, Lord, as we prepare ourselves for the reopening up of our nation together. And we learn again from another part of scripture, Isaiah 40, verse 31 says, "Those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." So Lord, we ask for this special anointing be given to all your people, that as we continue to wait upon you, we will renew our strength, mount up like wings, like eagles, shall run and not be weary, shall walk and not faint. So we pray, God, that we continue to put our trust and our faith in you, recognizing you are still the God of the universe who controls and moves among us. So we thank you for this peace that you give to us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father Lee also pray for our pastor, Pastor Emmanuel, as he preaches the word this morning to us, that you grant him the wisdom, the anointing, as he shares the word with us. We pray that you continue to watch over him as he continues his pastoral ministry, serving you and also the people together. To grant him the wisdom and the strength as he works in this ministry. I pray all this in Jesus' blessed name. Amen. So family now, together, let us sing the prayer the Lord has taught us, the Lord's Prayer.
Good morning, family. Welcome to the online worship service this morning. We are so glad that you can join us today. As we continue with our worship, here are some announcements on the latest news and happenings in our church. The QR codes and links will be on the screen, so get your phones ready. Firstly, we have a new initiative from some of the ladies in our church and from the WSCS. They will be sewing cloth masks and mailing them to those who need it. If you or your family need a cloth mask, you can submit a request using the QR code on your screen or the link in the e-bulletin. Additionally, if you wish to volunteer to be part of this initiative, please check the e-bulletin for the contact details of the person in charge and contact them for more details. On the 31st of May, we will be having our regular healing service. We will be doing our normal 9 a.m. pre-recorded service. After the service is over, there will be a Zoom prayer room for those who need prayer, and this Zoom prayer room will be open for about 15 minutes after service ends. To register for access to the Zoom prayer room, please refer to the e-bulletin or our website for more details. For all the other announcements and upcoming events in our church, we invite you to refer to the e-bulletin or our website for more information. You can find out more about the events that are listed on your screen. Let's continue to worship God by giving His time and our offering. We thank God for the blessing in our lives, knowing that God will supply all our needs to accomplish His will as we seek His kingdom together. Let's give with a cheerful heart. You'll be able to give your offering and pledges through PayNow. Remember to scan the PayNow QR code with your internet banking app and not with a regular QR code reader. For those of you who are here for the first time, there's no obligation to give. We are just glad that you can join us for service this morning. Let us pray. As we give our offering, let's remember that Jesus gave the ultimate sacrifice. May we also offer our whole lives as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
us praise God with the doxology.
Family and friends of AMKMC Methodist Church, welcome and thank you for joining us for our online service this morning. We have come a long way in our Romans Pulpit series, but don't give up, continue to press on because we are reaching the end of this series already. It might feel extra long, but it's only been about 5 months since we started. But nonetheless, do press on, okay? So let's pray before we hear God's word together. Will you join me in prayer? Father, as we come to you to hear your word as a family, grant us an individual specialized message from you, Lord, that as we hear your word, we will also be doers of your word, so that your name will be glorified, Lord. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today's passage is taken from Romans chapter 14 verse 1 to chapter 15 verse 6. And as I was preparing for it, I come to realize this. It's not something new. In fact, it is something we are very familiar with. As long as we have interaction with a friend, a family, or somebody else, be it online interaction or physical interaction, which we can't right now, we will face this issue. And this issue is we are very different in one way or another. We have different opinions, we have different personalities. Maybe some are more academic, some are more artistic, some are better with numbers, some are better with words, some are good at dancing. You know, God has made us so different and unique. And that's wonderful, right? I really thank God for making who I am. And we should be thankful of how God has made you to be. But when we come together as a church, or family or friends, we all have different opinions over a certain matter, right? So during this circuit breaker, my wife and I always have this issue. You know, we scratch our head, pull our hair, you know, and always have to find an answer to this question. And the question is, what to eat for breakfast, lunch or dinner? You know, we do not have an answer at times. You know, maybe certain days she wants Japanese, I want Western. Certain days we are okay with Asians or local or things like that. We have different opinions over a simple daily activity, right? What more the more complex ones? So if you want to, if I would ask you to share your the answers in the comment section, I'm sure it's going to range from so many to so many different answers. I can't even choose which one again, right? And this problem of having a different opinion also happened in the time of Paul. The Jewish Christian and the Gentile Christians were in fact arguing with one another. They couldn't get their act together, and Paul here is saying, hey guys, you know, wake up your idea. You know, you guys need to sort your differences out, and let me teach you how to sort your differences out. Right, and the real reason why he wants them to be in peace and harmony and not in conflict is really not just for the so-called nice, beautiful picture of just a church. It's actually more than that. And what do I mean by that? It states in chapter 15, verse 5, may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. The real reason why Paul wants them to stop arguing so is because that they can glorify the Lord with one voice. Right? Isn't that also what we want to do? We want to glorify God with one voice. As a body of Christ, we want to glorify God. And let us see how we can do that. You know, we can really do that in just three different steps or three different ways to glorify God with one voice. The first is to accept one another. The second is to not judge one another. And the third is to build one another up. So accept, do not judge, and build one another. And let's go straight into how we can start to glorify God with one voice through acceptance. Because acceptance is never easy. But it's definitely the first step. Paul mentioned it in the beginning of our passage in chapter 14, verse 1, or even the earlier parts, I can't remember offhand. But also in the end of chapter 15, verse 6 or 7, he mentioned about acceptance. Which I feel the NIV use this word as a more modern word usage.
like I accept you as a person, I accept you as my friend. But in the ESV or NLT version, the word is welcome is used. Maybe some other versions have the word receive. Receive also can be used to try to rephrase welcome and accept. But what these words really mean is to allow someone to access one's heart. You open up your heart and receive, welcome and accept somebody into your heart so that you become friends with one another. So if I were to say I accept you or I receive you, it means I'm willing to be your friend. Paul is calling the Christians in Rome to stop quarreling over differing opinions and be friends with one another, to live in harmony, to welcome each other with their, from the bottom of their hearts, not just with their words, but from their hearts. But what were they arguing about, if you were to ask, you know, what's wrong with them, you know, can't they just get their act together? What were they quarreling about? Essentially, these two groups were quarreling about food and Jewish holidays. And when I mean food, doesn't mean that they were quarreling about which store sells the best Hokkien mee or Cha Kway Teow, or for the younger people, which bubble tea shop sells the best bubble tea, or what kind of bubble tea is the best drinking bubble tea, you know. But Paul calls these two groups, calls them the weak and the strong, right? Not in physical strength, but in faith. He's calling those people who are weak, one group to be called weak in faith, and another group to those who are strong in faith. Generally, those who were weak in faith were the Jewish Christians, and the strong in faith were the Gentile Christians. Right? And here, the Jewish Christians who were weak in faith, they were not weak, not because they did not believe Jesus or his existence, but rather they were weak because of their conviction about what their faith allows him or her to do, as compared to the strong in faith who were allowed to do such things. So for example, the weak refrained from eating meat and they celebrated the Jewish holy days, as compared to the strong who do eat meat and they do not celebrate the Jewish holy days. Right. Both groups have strong opinions and conviction about this matter, and they were quarreling non-stop, you know, judging one another, condemning each other. And Paul calls a stop to this. But if you look at us, even as today we live in this modern society, we too have many areas that we are quarreling about in the church, right? And it's nothing new. Maybe you have your fair share of that too. We come from different backgrounds, different personalities, and of course, we have different opinions, right? The question here is not to change people to think alike, to speak alike, and to act alike. This is not what we want to do. But rather, we want to accept them, receive them, and welcome them. In other words, can we be friends with these people even though we have different opinions about such things? And here again, the reminder is that the opinions, the difference in opinion is not sinful in nature, right? These different opinions are not sinful in nature. If they were sinful in nature, it's very clear cut, right? But here it is not, right? So let me move on to my second point. Paul not just asks us not to accept one another, but also not to judge one another. He says to both groups in Romans chapter 14, verse 3 to verse 4, let not the one who eat despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats. For God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. Another verse, why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, each of you will give an account of himself to God. Just as Paul was speaking to Christians in Rome, he was also speaking to us today. Right? We are not to despise and judge one another, because all of us inevitably will be judged by God at the end of the day. We will have to give an account to Him personally. So instead of passing judgment, right, what we can do instead is to switch it, right, to what Paul wants us to do, which is to never put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. And that is found in Romans 14:13. Right? So not only we are called not to judge, but we're also called not to put a stumbling block or hindrance to a fellow believer. And what do I mean by that? What's a stumbling block? A stumbling block is anything that causes another person to stumble, which means to fall. And a hindrance is to trap someone, a fellow believer, into falling into sin. How might that look like today for us? Let me illustrate. Let me give you an example about maybe alcohol. Some people suddenly now awake, pay attention, you know, because alcohol, you know, but as you and I know, as Methodist ministers and also for Holy Communion, we do not partake alcohol. We do not partake wine in our Holy Communion. And since today is also Aldersgate Sunday, I would like to remind us that back then, John Wesley did not use wine in the celebration of Holy Communion was because he was actually ministering to former alcoholics. And by using wine, he might cause them to stumble and go back into addiction of alcohol. Hence, today, we are still using grape juice instead of wine. Isn't that wonderful? Our founder, John Wesley, advocated and practiced this act of not stumbling a fellow believer. It's also a reminder for us, you know, as Christians, if we have that sensitivity to our fellow believer, our fellow believers, our churchmates, our friends, who might be weak in such areas, we do not stumble them. We do not perform some acts, we refrain from that, so that other people will not be stumbled, other people will not be hindered, and they fall into this trap of sinning. If we can do that, isn't that wonderful? Right? And the third point for today, which I want to focus a bit more time, really, is to build someone up. Right? To build one another up. And that is important, because in Romans 15:2, we are called to build one another up. We are called to build one another up. And one of the first way we can do that is through our words. Ephesians 4:29 says, "Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up, as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear." And as we all know, there is tremendous power in our words. Words can build us up. Words can also tear us down. And the Bible has a lot to say about all our experience about this. And we have a lot of experiences with it. Right? If I were to ask you personally, what words have hurt you before, or what words have encouraged you before, I'm sure you have many stories to tell. Many, many stories to tell. And I would love to hear them. So do share with me, do share with your cell members, do share with someone about how you have been blessed and encouraged before. But in my short experience in church, in church ministry or Christian ministry, on numerous accounts, I have heard of someone who have stopped coming to church because he or she has personally been hurt by some words. Be it said about them or be it said about somebody else, they have been hurt by those words. So can I encourage you, if you have been hurt by it, you know, do go to the Lord. Do bring your hurts to the Lord and let Him heal, let God heal you today. It's not easy to uncover, to go back to such wounds, but it's necessary for our spiritual life. We need to go to God with our hurts and let Him, who is the healer, who is the physician, heal us of our wounds. Having said that, if we know the power of words that can hurt us and also can encourage us, can I encourage you today to really share a positive word to build maybe your cell leader up, your ministry leader, or even your spouse or children? It's about time that maybe they need to hear an encouraging word from you today. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, "Therefore encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. When we use our tongues to encourage one another, express our appreciation, help each other see God working in our lives." I think when we do that, we are helping God, helping others to see God in their life. And it's important for that to happen. The second way we can build somebody up is to encourage, is to walk in love with them. What do I mean by that? Romans 14:14-15 says, "I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. But by what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died." So as far as non-sinful things are concerned, Paul says, "I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing in itself is unclean." He was not stating a personal opinion or preference about such things, but was convinced in the Lord Jesus that it is true. What he's saying is true. It is from the Lord Jesus himself. What does that mean to us today? Right? So if a Christian who is careless use of his or her freedom causes other believers, other Christians to be in grief or hurt, this person, this Christian is no longer walking in love. And the best safeguard against grieving another believer conscious is really to do the opposite. Instead of hurting somebody, you are sensitive to the person's needs and you walk in love to build that person up. So if I give an example of what Christian freedom means, it's very much like walking on a tightrope. As you know, when you walk on a tightrope, you have a balancing pole, right? You hold a balancing pole and you do your best to walk across a tightrope. On one end of the pole is love, and on the other end is Christian freedom. We need to have a right balance of it so that we do not stumble somebody else. We do not grieve or hurt another believer. It's only when we balance love and Christian freedom. Martin Luther sums it up very nicely. "A Christian man is the most free lord of all, subject to none. A Christian man is the most dutiful servant of all, subject to all." See, friends and family, we are all immensely free in Christ. We have the freedom in Christ to do what He wants us to do. But we also are bond, we are also in bondage, but we are in bondage of love, love for one another, love to our fellow believers, and love to build them up. One of these ways is to walk in love. The third way to build somebody up is to not destroy or tear down the work of God. And Romans 14:20-21 says, "Do not, for the sake of food, destroy the work of God. Everything is indeed clean, but it is wrong for anyone to make another stumble by what he eats. It is good not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that causes your brother to stumble. But do not destroy the work of God." Do not destroy the work of God. Here, Paul is saying that in order to build another person up, you must not tear down what God has been building. And in this sense, it's the physical building, the spiritual building of a fellow believer that God has been doing. And God will continue to do. For example, if a child or a baby infant first arrive at home, parents will be very mindful of sharp edges, scissors, any object that will harm the child. If the child is careless or accidentally knocks his head against the furniture, we are very mindful of such things. But as the child grows up to become more matured and more independent, the parent will generally relax his rules, allow for maybe the scissors to be lying around, or even for the child to use the scissors for art and craft purposes. Likewise, a young Christian needs to have a stable fellowship, a stable group of matured believers, so that the young Christian can grow up to be matured Christians too. And as the young Christian is growing up, matured Christians must allow him or her to walk in ways that God is building this person up. Everybody is on a different journey. Yours and mine, we are all on different journeys. So there must be space for a young believer to grow in the ways of God and how God wants him or her to grow too. We are all on a different journey in our Christian walk. Some are ahead, some are behind, some have a deeper relationship with God, and some do not. It's okay. In this journey, we have different opinions about certain matters, and that's fine. The lesson from Paul and the Bible is that we as believers should live in peace and harmony among one another. And this is because we want to glorify God with one voice. And to do so, we need to accept one another as friends from the bottom of our hearts. Let us not judge one another and cause another believer to stumble and fall into sin. Instead, let us build one another up through our words and even our actions. Also, we should build one another up by walking in love towards our fellow believer. And third, we should not tear down the work of God if we want to build them up. So with all these steps, my prayer is that you will continue to persevere on to build this body of Christ up together as a family. As an AMKMC Methodist Church family, will you put in all that you can to build one another up? And I pray that you will, because the Bible will convict us, the Word of God will convict our hearts to be aligned with one another. So will you join me in prayer as we align our hearts and our minds to glorify God? Let us pray. Father, as we come to you as a body of Christ, as a church, as fellow Christians, Lord, we ask that you align our hearts and our minds and even our spirit as one, Lord, one in unity, one in harmony, one in peace with one another. Lord, you look at our hurts, you forgive, and you mend and heal our hurts. Those hurts that has maybe formed many years ago, Lord, we ask for a complete healing and forgiveness, Lord. That through which my brothers and sisters, Lord, will live in peace and harmony because we desire to glorify your name. So we put you first as the head of our church and as our spiritual family. You are the head, Lord. So Father, may you bind us together. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, family. I hope I can see you real soon. But in the meantime, do stay safe. I pray that God's word will continue to encourage you as you read them, as you meditate on them during this circuit breaker. May you be blessed by God's word today.
Here are the class meeting questions for this week. We encourage you to join a cell group if you are not already in one to discuss these questions. Let us now respond to God's word by singing the song of response.
with the Son of God, one with our sister, one with our brother, one family by the blood. Make us one.
Heavenly Father, teach us how to love and accept one another in the manner that you want us to. May your Spirit guide us to overcome our pride, our selfishness, and our fleshly desires, so that in loving as you have commanded, we may show the world that you are real and that you are a God of love. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray that you have been blessed by the service this morning and that God has spoken to you, be it words of encouragement or words of instruction. Let us remember that Jesus had said that the wise man is the one who hears God's word and acts on it. Before Pastor Anthony pronounces the benediction, we will be receiving a second offering for the Track Lease Renewal Fund. This fund is administered by the Trinity Annual Conference to provide financial assistance to 21 Track local churches in relation to the renewal of church land leases. We ask that you prayerfully consider and give as God guides you. If you miss the PayNow QR code, or if you would like to find out more about how you can give in Ang Mo Kio Methodist Church, you can visit amkmc.org.sg/give. If you wish to share a prayer request or a testimony, or if you would like to simply get in touch with one of our pastoral staff, you can contact us through the link that is on your screen. If you want to find out more about news and information about Ang Mo Kio Methodist Church, you can visit our website at amkmc.org.sg. Also, remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel and to click on the bell icon next to the subscribe button. This way, YouTube will notify you when we upload any videos to our YouTube channel or when our service video goes on air. Let's invite Pastor Anthony to pronounce the benediction over us.
And now, family, let me pronounce the blessings of God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant you His peace, that you may bring His peace into the world. Amen. God bless you. See you again soon.